Oh, thank you all for the wonderful time away. My sabbatical was what I hoped that it would be, even though it feels like I just put my toe in the water. Maybe it feels like that from your side too. You may remember there were three sources that inspired my sabbatical project. The first one was Peter Mayer's Holy Now. We had that same video about a year and a half ago, and we sang along with it. The second one was Marianne Moore's story, Hide and Seek with God, a version of which I just shared with the children. And the third is an old teaching story by Rabbi Isaac Luria, which sparked the entire Tikkun Olam, repair of the world movement in Judaism. In the rabbi's story, God and the earth are separated from one another to make room for something new to come into being. And God sends vessels filled with light across the space between the source, which is holy, and the world where humankind are to abide. And for one reason or another, those vessels shatter during the journey, and sparks and droplets of light are spilled out throughout all of the creation that we know. And humankind is created for the sole purpose of gathering up those sparks through and by acts of kindness and attention and justice making to release those sparks to rejoin the source. And the story says that when all the sparks of holiness and light have been gathered up again, then the earth will be holy and God will once again be everywhere. So, for my sabbatical, I decided I would go looking for sparks. I would see if Peter Mayer's song, Holy Now, might actually be true, and everything was holy if you could pay attention. And I thought, well, maybe if I had time enough and some practice, keeping my eyes and my heart open enough, I may get more than just that little flash at the corner of your eye that the poem refers to. The poet Alma Luis Villanueva writes, "The sacred is not in heaven or far away, it's all around us." And then she gives us a clue. Small human rituals can help connect us to its presence. So one of the very first things I did at the beginning of the sabbatical was to come up with a very tiny ritual that I could do every single morning. Before I opened my eyes, I would do what I did with the children. I would count backwards from 5 to 1, and then I'd open my eyes and I'd say, "Ready or not, here I come." And then I would go about my day. Just whatever happened to be on the schedule, whatever was going on with my kids and the world and errands, and trying to pay attention to sparks that might show up, that I might become aware of, to someone doing something kind, to something beautiful, to something strange. And some of these I captured and you got to read in the little emails and the pictures. I found the holy in the snowfall and in the storm clouds and in the rainbows and the flowers and the baby chickens and, you know, all of those ordinary things. And I found the holy here at church when I had the rare experience of sitting in the courtyard and not having to be in any of the 5 meetings that were going on in the church. And I watched as people came and went, and I listened to the hum of voices and the chanting and the sound of sword fighting in the other room from the upstart crows. And it was wonderful, and I realized that one of the things that you need to do if you want to sort of savor what is going on in your life is every now and then you need to step back a little bit and take the chance to be on the margins watching. Because when you're in the thick of it, it's a really different experience. Now, by and by, life intervened, and what started out as very spacious sabbatical days filled up with commitments. And several days would go by, and even with the intention to pay attention, even counting backwards and saying, ready or not, here I come, days would go by, and I would realize that I hadn't noticed something, or I would realize that after the fact, that something really wonderful had happened and I hadn't been aware of it while it was going on, or I would be in the middle of it and I would be so engaged and I would be so aware, but there would be no way to capture it. You know, when you're in the middle of the room full of people chanting, you can't go digging in your bag to get out your cell phone so you can record the sound of the voices. It just isn't done. So I got stuck, because I didn't want to just find those sparks. I wanted to share them with you. Because while it's delicious to find a spark and have the experience of transcending mystery and wonder, it's even more fun to share it with other people. And so I decided that I would take a cue from the children's story, and I would actually go looking for the holy in places that I had glimpsed that sense of mystery and wonder at other points in my life, and see if maybe the holy was still there if I would pay attention. And so I went to the little waterfall up in Hyde Park where we have picnicked as a congregation. And I didn't go once, I went three times. And I took Isaac with me because he's happy to climb up the waterfall and let me sit at the bottom of it for 2 or 3 hours. He's not in a hurry. And so we went to the waterfall. And the first time I just sat. And then I went home and wrote. And then the second time I took pictures and videos. And I shared them with Jim, who was going to put them together help me put them together. And he sent me back another time to do audio files. And the voice of the waterfall was the video short and poetry that came back to you, a spark, a glimpse of something a little bit magical. I also went looking at Harry's Roadhouse. Most Thursday mornings, I have coffee with an interfaith group of clergy at Harry's Roadhouse. And I said, okay, guys, I'm on sabbatical. Where do you find the holy? And I was really sure, I was positive, someone was going to say something wonderful and esoteric about a breathing practice or an ancient text or some discipline. And the colleague across the table said, you know, the place I most reliably find the holy is when my grandchild comes down from his bedroom upstairs and climbs on my lap while I'm having coffee. And we spent an hour talking about all of the children in everyone's lives, the foster children, the real children, the grandchildren, the children in trouble, the children who had died, the children in our congregations. And absolutely, there was something magical moving through that group of clergy as they talked about the children they loved. And at the end, I realized I hadn't taken any pictures. So I took a picture of the table and the coffee cups, and I promised myself the next time I meet with my clergy colleagues, I'm going to take some more pictures of the corner and the table and Harry's. But I haven't gotten back to Harry's yet. So that will come to you with the poem that came out of it when it's time. And what I learned was that I have to be patient. Showing up is good, but you have to show up and be present, and then you have to leave time afterwards for it to sink in and bubble up again in a new form. I found that when I went someplace with the intention to pay attention, and when I was willing to make several visits, and when I allowed myself the time to sit with the experience while I was in it and afterwards, I was rewarded with both what our sources call the direct experience of transcending mystery and wonder, and the ability to translate it and share it with someone else. So I learned that I needed time and bandwidth, and I learned that I needed to practice both paying attention and pulling out the camera. And I realized that the game, or maybe it's a spiritual practice, works better when I stay focused. And a funny thing happened. Along about the beginning of month three, my morning ritual evolved. Instead of saying 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ready or not, here I come, it was 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, whether I'm ready or not. And then there was a blank. God, love, patience, creativity, wisdom, here I come. And that was the face of the holy I would find myself looking for that day. And I had to laugh, because after writing down the name of the holy that I was looking for each day for a few weeks or a few days, I realized that my lovely humanist synonyms coincide astonishingly with the Jewish and Christian and Muslim names for God. I'm not sure what to make of that, but there it is. So if the first ritual was the countdown, then the second ritual each day was morning coffee with my journal and my books. And I started out having the coffee and writing and reading that do-nothing poem and using it as an icon or a picture frame or a lens. Because I discovered what many of you may have known for years, but you can take a poem, and if you read it in the early morning, you can look through that poem at your day, as you go about your day. And when you look through the right piece of poetry, one that speaks to your heart, then you can see things that spark or that glimmer that your unaided mind has trouble focusing on. So I read lots of books looking for wonderful lenses to look through. I read poetry and philosophy. I read books many of you have given me over the years. I read whatever was on the new bookshelf at the library. I read a stack of things from General Assembly. And I have lots of little marks in those books so I can share the poems with you in the days to come. Now, the third little ritual for encountering the holy, should you want to try to do it yourself, seems rather counterintuitive even to me. I realized that I had to put my search for sparks on my to-do list. Yep. Even without church obligations, I realized that I am easily distracted by mundane urgencies, like getting my kids where they need to be, making sure the ingredients for dinner are in the refrigerator, and making sure that the laundry gets transferred into the dryer before it goes sour. So it turned out there wasn't a magical housekeeping fairy that showed up during the sabbatical. I actually needed to schedule my trips to the waterfall. I needed to put it on the calendar that I was going to go to the prayer circle or to the Celtic Evensong, because otherwise it just didn't happen. So if you look at my to-do list sometime, you might find that there's a little chalice icon inserted in between meeting one and meeting number two, or between drive the kids to rehearsal and go and do the grocery store shopping. And those little chalice circles are reminders to myself to stop and breathe and see if there are any sparks in the room. Sometimes there's even a little note that says, stop and take a picture. See what shows up. I have this fantasy that I'll take a photograph someday and the holy will show up in the photograph like one of those blobs of ectoplasm in the photographs people used to take at seances. But so far it hasn't happened. When people have come to me over the years asking for help in finding something that they want in their lives, love or a job or a more creative way of being, I have often found myself saying, well, you know, when I want to find seashells, I usually go walk on the beach. Part of making the list and putting the holy on the list was reminding myself to go walk on the beach and actually look for the shells. So it's been an interesting project these last 3 months, particularly for a humanist non-theist. Looking for and encountering what I understand as transcending mystery and wonder, the holy. And at the end of these 3 months, I'm still a religious or spiritual humanist. But if the Reverend Wayne Mueller, a Christian colleague who writes about Sabbath, if he can be known throughout the Jewish community as the goyim who loves the Sabbath, I figure I wouldn't mind being known through the Unitarian Universalist community as the humanist who loves the holy. It has a nice ring to it, I think. That discipline of looking for and encountering what I realized was our first source, direct experience with transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, which moves us to a renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces that create and uphold life. That discipline, going and looking for that, has proved to be tremendously rejuvenating. I had hoped I would have a book full of sparks to share with you after 3 months. And the truth is, I have about a handful. But eventually, I hope there will be enough to create a book so that you can have, sitting by your bedside or in your study, a collection of lenses to look through, to help you pay attention to what is wonderful and life-affirming in your own lives. Now comes the hard part. Because as you know, if you've ever gone on a spiritual retreat or been to a UU summer camp or even gone to General Assembly, coming down off the mountain and re-entering ordinary life and hanging on to some little piece of that goodness that you encountered is the challenge. And I'm not quite sure how I'm going to do that. I'm pretty sure you'll be willing to help me. I know it's something that we have to do together. I also know that you too have been on sabbatical. You've been on the other end of the sabbatical, on the stepping forward and making sure things still happen here end of the sabbatical. And if it worked, this sabbatical, then you will have learned as much about what it means for you to be church here without me as I learned going looking for the holy. And so, as we re-enter being church together, I really want to hear from you what you loved about the last 3 months, what you missed during the last 3 months, what things you want to keep that you've been doing differently, and what things you might want to hand back. We have 12 months, or maybe 13, of being together and being church together, being community together, before I get to do part two of my sabbatical and go away for another 3 months. So it's this wonderful time where we can come up with an experiment and we know it has an end. And then we'll get to reinvent ourselves all over again. And so I would invite you to please join me in bringing what we've learned together to this place so that we can carry it with us for the whole 12 months until we do it all again. Blessed be.